All right, y'all, it's time for church. How's everyone doing? Yes? You're happy that it's time for church? I'm happy that you're happy that it's time for church. My name is Ramirez. I serve as the campus pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And it's so great to be in God's house with you to worship Him together. It's an honor and a privilege that we should never take for granted. And I'm excited that you guys are excited to worship the Lord together. And if this is your first time joining us today, I'm also excited that you've decided to do that. And I would love the opportunity to meet you, so I will be in the lobby after church. I'd love to see how I can serve you during your time here at Harvest Bible Chapel. Harvest, in our continuing efforts to care for you, we have the Harvest Bible Chapel app. So if you have that on your phone, if you don't mind, pull your phone out and check in. It not only lets us know that you're here today, but it also allows us the opportunity to pray for you as well. Our staff counts it a great joy to pray for the people in our church. But it also lets us know, like, what's happening in your life. And you're able to know what's happening in the church because our calendar is there, and the different ways to get connected here at Harvest is there as well. Harvest, I'm excited. I'm always excited. I just love coming to church, man. But I'm excited about a workshop that we are offering in September. It's happening Friday, September 6th through Saturday morning, September 7th. And it's called The Journey to Generosity. And in this workshop, we will hear testimonies. We're going to open up God's Word to find out what He says about generosity. And we're going to have a time of reflection on those things. And so I would encourage you to go into the Harvest Bible Chapel app and register for this event, or you can go to harvestbible.org to do that as well, as we seek the Lord and what He has for us as far as being more generous. Harvest, in our continuing efforts to pray for like-minded churches, today we are lifting up Mission Church in Bloomingdale and their pastor, John Peacock. Will you join me as we pray for Missions Church? Lord, we thank You for what You are doing in the churches throughout the Chicagoland area, especially those who are preaching Your Word in its proper context and reaching out to the surrounding communities. And Missions Church is one of them. And so, God, we lift them up today. We just ask that You continue to provide all of the needs in their ministry, continue to support and strengthen the staff as they are on mission for You in the community that they are located in. And so, God, will You continue to provide all of the needs of their ministry as well? We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, Harvest. This is what you came here for, right? It's one of the things, not everything. But we get to worship the Lord together, so let's stand to our feet and do that.
I have seen the goodness of my God throughout my living years. There has never been a moment I ever walked alone. Through fire or through famine, I've never been abandoned. And Your goodness keeps on going beyond my living years. You will be faithful, so constant and so true. You'll be able to do what I can't do when it's more than I can handle. In the face of all my fears, You'll be faithful beyond my living years. Yeah.
Take a minute right now to read a couple scriptures. They'll be on the screen. Take a minute to reflect, and may the word of God speak over you right now.
Them beauty,
I don't have to wonder. You know what you're doing. So why would I worry at all? 'Cause you're faithful to supply.
That's right.
And everything I need, and everything I need, my Father has it. My Father has it. And every single time, the Lord will provide. My Father has it. My Father has it. Yeah. My Father has it. Look at the sparrow, lacking for nothing.
That's right.
No fear of tomorrow, and what it will bring. If I have you, I have enough, 'cause your love will satisfy. Everything I need, and everything I need, I know my Father has it. My Father has it. And every single time, the Lord will provide. My Father has it. My Father has it. Yeah. Oh, my Father has it. I believe. First the kingdom and its treasures, and everything else it will be added. 'Cause all that I'm needed, 'cause I know the Lord will provide. 'Cause I know my God's not empty-handed, 'cause He gives us blessing upon.
Revelation says, and I hear a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I'm making everything new. Let's respond in song.
Thank you.
right, Harvest, we're going to continue worshiping, but through our giving. Here's what it says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 through 19. It says, as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly provides us everything to enjoy. And then it says this, they are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasures for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take a hold of that which is truly life. As we worship the Lord in our giving, it should be done with a generous heart, and it should be done with total and utter trust in the Lord. And so, if you take a look at the screen, you'll see the different ways that you have to give here at Harvest Bible Chapel. But as you do that, let's remember who our source is. God has given us the ability to get wealth, and he's entrusting us to just give a portion of that back to him to further his kingdom here on earth. So let's pray for this week's offering. Lord, we thank you for the ability to get wealth, and we thank you for being a provider. And so, God, it is our prayer that what we have chosen to give to you tonight with a cheerful heart, that it may be pleasing in your sight. Lord, use it to further your gospel, further than we could have ever imagined. Lord, we thank you, and we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. All right, Harvest, why don't you take this time to greet someone who you did not come to church with?
Hi. It's good to see you. How are you? Thanks. Well, I've been gone for a while. For those of you who didn't notice, you've been gone for a while too. All right. Some of you did notice. You said, I've been here and you've not been here. I've had a few weeks off and it's been great. Got a chance to see my son play baseball up in Cape Cod, which is a great place to go in the summer. And that was outstanding. But I'm really excited to be back and to be able to share God's word together with you. You're going to need a Bible, and you're going to need to open it to a book in the Old Testament. It's a little one, okay? Joel, the book of Joel, chapter 1, verse 13 is where we're going to start. I want to study the verses 13 to 20 today with you. Joel 1, verses 13 to 20. While you're turning there, I got to tell you that one of my favorite stories in the Bible that you will hear me repeat, you already have, I've been here at Harvest for 3 years, and you will hear me repeat it over and over again, is actually the story of the prodigal son. You like it too, I know. I think there's something about the story of grace and kindness and this picture of God's or the father scanning the horizon, waiting for his wanton son to return, that just touches our hearts in a remarkable way. We don't usually focus as much on the second prodigal son, who's his older brother, who's mad because the party's being had without him, which is just as important and probably the point of the passage a little bit more. But there's a part of the story that sits in my head quite a bit. And it's the part, the story of the prodigal son, most people obviously know it. He goes to his dad, says, give me all the money, because I don't care if you live or die. Just give me my inheritance. His father's gracious, gives him the money. He takes off, and he squanders it over a period of years on a riotous living, is one of the translations says. And so he's off doing that, and eventually he ends up with all his friends having left him. He's penniless, and he ends up in a feed stall, basically, with a bunch of pigs. Now, if you're a Jewish kid, pigs are kind of untouchable. And then, so if you're eating the food that the pigs eat, after the pigs eat it, the idea is that you're lower than the pigs. And it's that part of the story that rolls around in my head. What switched in the guy's mind to make him just realize? Was it halfway through one of the corns on the cob with the pig slobber on it? Or where was he? Was he in the mud? Picture him in your mind's eye. Everything has gone wrong. His plans have been laid to waste. And he has a moment of pristine clarity. Some of us have had those moments of pristine clarity. I had a friend, actually, who crashed his car once, and I remember him telling me that his father came to the site of the crash. He should have died. He said the car was mangled, rolled over and over again, and he said his father, he was fine. He got out of the car and was standing, you know, he had the blanket around him or whatever it was, and he was standing there watching them come and bring the tow truck to come and drag the thing away, and his father was standing there next to him, his father who had warned him repeatedly to drive more safely, as all good fathers do. We were young men once too. And he was standing there next to his father, and his father with his arms crossed, and they weren't looking at each other, they were looking at the crash. His father didn't say, I told you so, but my friend told me, I don't think I've ever had quite that moment of clarity in my life. I should have died. But here I am standing alive. I should have died because I didn't listen to the man who's standing next to me. Thank you, God, for this message. The book of Joel is basically a moment of clarity for the people of Israel. You ever heard people say, I just wish that God was sending me a message. Joel, the book of Joel is like, oh, I got a message for you. The people of Israel have walked away from the Lord as they did. In particular, on this occasion, they had walked away from the Lord by worshiping other gods and goddesses, but quietly. You know, it's not something that you would go and publish everywhere, but quietly. They would still go and worship the Lord, the Yahweh, in the temple, and they do all the things that you're supposed to do, you know, like in our day, going to church and giving the money and doing all the righteous kind things, right? They volunteered at the coffee counter, whatever. They kept following the religious calendar, you know, so they could keep themselves on God's good side, they thought. But behind the scenes, when it came to their crops, they were worshiping the idols. The other gods, right? Which is a tempting thing to do. You and I who, you know, if you live in difficult financial times or you aren't sure that the crops are going to be provided, yes, you're thinking to yourself, well, Yahweh could provide them, but just to cover my bases, I might want to, you know, throw a few shekels, you know, Baal's way. I might want to put up a quiet Asherim pole in the back so that, you know, Asherim knows that I worship her. Just don't tell anybody, especially my Jewish friends. So they worship God, but also worship the idols, thinking, of course, that they could hide it. And then the worst thing happened. Locusts. Do you guys know what locusts are? We haven't. You know, the cicadas? Okay, imagine those cicadas all decided to get together and got angry with you. You know, the ones you hear all in all the trees, you're like, boy, I'm glad they're staying in the trees. All right, what if they didn't stay in the trees? I'll show you. God bless the BBC, BBC Earth, all right? Here's what they say about cicadas. Sorry, locusts. The same thing.
Locusts. They're normally solitary insects. But when there's an abundance of crops, their numbers can reach plague proportions. These flightless hoppers can form armies a kilometer long. But they have only just begun on their path of destruction. At 5 weeks old, they morph into fully fledged adults. Take to the air in their millions. A swarm this size may only appear once in a decade in Madagascar. Reaching the highlands, a plague is finally stopped by the heavy mountain rains. Wet wings prevent the locusts from flying until eventually the swarm runs out of food and dies.
So Israel had a swarm of locusts like that. And they ate everything. This what we call an agrarian economy, meaning that they lived off of the agriculture. The locust swarm came and it devoured all the things. They called it evil. Bill Gates just calls it dinner. No? Okay. But here's the thing that's really interesting. In the book of Joel says, you guys remember the locust swarm that came and ate all of the stuff and that ruined you financially? I know you think that that's the judgment of God upon you, and it is, but it's actually just an object lesson judgment, because the locusts are just a sign of what will come when the Babylonians show up. And what you saw the locusts do to the plants, the Babylonians are going to do to you. Oh, plants. But now you have a moment of clarity. God knows what you're doing in your backyard. Your hidden sins, he knows. He knows them. Maybe you should consider another path. It's a great book, man. It really is. I'm sad that I only get to do one little passage out of it, but the question that this book is really trying to deal with is, what do you do when it all comes crashing down? What do you do when your deceitfulness, your lying, your cheating, your stealing, your actions that were done in private have ruined your life, whether they're known by everyone or not, but they have led you to a place where you're standing over your own car wreck of a life and thinking, oh, clarity. So look, what do you do in that moment? This passage is actually going to instruct us to do three things. Number one, you got to get real about it. You got to look at the car wreck and get real about it. Number two, you got to own up to it. And third, you got to cry out about it. Get real about it, own up to it, cry out about it. So let's kind of use those as our headers to our outline. Here we go. Number one. You gotta get real about it. Look at verse 13 of Joel chapter 1. So the locusts have come, and they're just a sign of what's going to come with the Babylonians, but they have this moment. And in this moment, says Joel, I need you put on sackcloth, and lament, O priests. Wail, O ministers of the altars. He's basically calling all of the leaders of the church, the leaders of God's people, to gather together and to put on mourning clothes. I think I've shared this before with you. Sackcloth is like, remember those potato sacks? I don't even know. I don't buy potatoes very often, but they used to come in these burlap sacks that were super, super itchy. And I always remember when I went to church when I was a little kid, I felt like my sweater was one of those burlap sacks. I couldn't wait to take it off. It was this itchy sweater. But if you've ever worn anything that has that kind of rough material, it's the opposite of bamboo. It's that rough material. Well, you're supposed to wear this. When you take off your normal clothes, go and get your morning outfit, which is made of sackcloth. Usually it was in black. And it was rough on your skin, often would give you a rash, so that the outside of you would match how you're feeling inside. Like, look, Lord, I am giving myself discomfort physically so that I can show to you my heart is in discomfort because of what I've done to you. I don't know if you've ever met somebody who said, I can't even get out of bed. This is a good example of somebody who's like, well, I can't. My heart is so broken, is so in the shadows, that I want to cover myself up and only be in the shadows physically. My soul needs to be matched by my body. And so put on sackcloth and lament, O priests. Wail. I don't know if you've ever heard these folks wail. There were professional wailers, which is, I'm not kidding. I know people who do really well at that, some two-year-olds, right? Oh, ministers of the altar, go in. I want you to pass the night in sackcloth. Everybody loves their jammy pants, yes? Yes, you're going to go home this evening, and guess what you're putting on? Your jammy pants. Because the jammy pants are the most comfortable thing you own. And this is, you know, when COVID happened and everybody got to stay home from work, they were happy, mostly because they got to wear their jammy pants all day. And they'd sit there and they'd wear their jammy pants. But these guys are supposed to pass the night. Normally, when you were mourning, you could take your sackcloth off in the evening, but not this time. You need to be so aware of how bad it is that I don't want you to take off this clothing, this morning clothing at all. There, no break. O ministers of my God, because grain offering and drink offering are withheld from the house of your God, consecrate a fast. Call a solemn assembly. You would have one of these things like once a year maybe. It's sort of like our Christmas, like you have or a very serious day, you know, Day of Atonement. You would have a very serious, solemn day, but he's saying, this is time for a special family meeting, everyone. And I want you to act in this family meeting, this emergency meeting, the same way you would act in the saddest day of the year. Nobody eats anything.
Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land. Everybody's coming to the house of the Lord your God and cry out to the Lord. Red alert. That's how bad this is. Well, why is it so bad? I skipped right through this, but because grain offering and drink offering are withheld from the house of your God. This is such an interesting statement. Basically, because they had been so secretive about their disobedience to God, because they'd been so secretive about their idolatry, God was like, I sent the locusts. See, you guys, I sent the locusts so you wouldn't even have stuff to worship me with. You don't really worship me. I know you think you're the only ones who see that you don't really worship me. I mean, you do it physically, but in your hearts, you don't really worship me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to match what's really going on in your hearts with what's going on physically with you. You don't want to worship me? Fine. You don't get the stuff to worship with me. The locusts ate it. Or in other words, God cares an awful lot more about the posture of your spirit toward him than he does the perfunctory rituals that we do because we're told to. I mean, that's really the point. When I say that the first thing that you need to do is you need to get real about it, that's really the point here. Don't deceive yourself. God can't be mocked. You think, and I think, that the things that we do in private are just in private. They're not in private. It's a theological error. Just listen very closely to me. God is omniscient. That means all-knowing. God is omnipresent. That means he's everywhere all at once. But my brain can't handle that. Right, because you're neither of those. He knows all. He sees all. So when you and I think, yeah, but not my secret things, you're like, what? What? You're acting like an idiot. And there is a long history of biblical idiots who've tried to act this way. I just want to take you a short tour. We could spend all day with the idiots of the Bible. That's a good sermon series. Right, the idiots of the Bible. So, okay, let's start at the very get-go. How about Adam and Eve? Okay, Adam and Eve are in the garden, and they're not supposed to eat the fruit from the tree, eat anything else. Serpent comes along, says, you won't die. Eve's like, well, okay, maybe. So they eat, and what's the first thing that they do? After they eat, their eyes are open so that they know that they're naked. And the first thing that they do, these brilliant people, here's the language, Genesis 3:8. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife, okay, here we go, hid themselves from the presence of the, can I just put in here, omniscient and omnipresent, no? They hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God in the most creative place among the trees of the garden. He won't find me over here, right? You guys, I got a magic trick, right? Here I am. See? Magic! I disappeared. And you're like, you're so dumb. Right? Because that's stupid. That's stupid to think that you can somehow hide from God, that the thing that you just did was so secretive that he's not going to find it, especially if you hide it behind the big oak tree. Yes, but maybe I should dig a hole in the ground and hide it. Okay, I'll give you a guy who dug a hole in the ground. His name was Achan. They go into the promised land, the people of Israel, and they are told, Joshua is leading the people of Israel, and they are told that if you obey me and follow my ways, that you'll experience great success and victory over the peoples of the land. So they conquer Jericho, and then the next place they go is called, depending on whether you want to pronounce it AI or just AI is spelled. So they show up there, And they lose. And Joshua's like, what is going on? God, you said that we would be fine. As long as we obeyed you, we've obeyed you. And God's like, no, no, no. There's somebody who stole some stuff from Jericho. Remember when I told you, Joshua, that when you go into Jericho, all the stuff you take is supposed to be devoted to me? Yeah. Even the treasures and everything? Uh-huh. Well, there's somebody in your camp who decided to take something. Oh, but how did you know, Lord? Okay. How are we going to find out? Oh, you'll find out. So he gets all the people of Israel to stand out in front, and then he goes like by tribes and by clans inside the tribes and by drawing lots, right? And they pull lots out, and it gets down to this tribe, and they pull a lot out, and it gets down to this tribe, and then the members of the family within the tribe, and eventually we're left through the lucky picking of lots. The lot finally falls on Achan. And Joshua says to Achan in Joshua 7:19, my son, give glory to the Lord of Israel, God of Israel, and give praise to him, and tell me now what you have done. Don't hide it from me. And Achan answered Joshua, truly, I've sinned against the Lord. I mean, he's just watched all the lots fall on him. You can see this guy in the back going, they'll never find me. And that just one by one. There, truly, I've sinned against the Lord God of Israel. And this is what I did when I saw among the spoil a beautiful cloak, right? It was from Burlington, and it was beautiful. From Shinar, and 200 shekels of silver and a bar of gold weighing 50 shekels. Then I coveted them, and I took them. And see, they're hidden where God can't find them. In the earth. But it's inside my tent. With the silver underneath. Dude, I put it under my bunk. He'll never find it. The original Hogan's Heroes. If you get that joke, good for you. Right? No, they'll never find it. God's like Clink. He's never going to figure it out. If you didn't get that joke, you are missing out on one of the great shows in the history of Hogan's Heroes. But he's an idiot. Because you can't hide something from the Lord, right? These Old Testament passages. It's a good thing God's different in the New Testament. Okay, Ananias and Sapphira. Acts chapter 5. They show up and they got some land and they're like, we're going to sell our land. They say to each other, we're going to sell our land and then we'll report that what we gave to the church was more than what actually we gave out of it, okay? Therefore, but we'll do it publicly, and everyone will think, you guys are so kind, you gave all the money. But we're not giving all the money, we're giving a portion of it, okay? But it's just between you and me and nobody else, because nobody else in the entire universe can hear us. So they make this plan, and Ananias shows up and he walks forward at the meeting. His wife is somewhere else. He walks forward to the meeting and smiling, and everyone's like, oh, look at how much money he's bringing forward to set before the apostles. And Peter gets, he gets a liver quiver, and he's like, whoa, the Holy Spirit's telling me that this isn't the whole thing. Is this the whole thing? Yes, it's the whole thing. You liar, says Peter. Because you said that, the Spirit of God's going to knock you down right where you are. You're dead. Boom, he's down. And they carry him out. A little while later, Sapphira shows up, and no one tells her. They want to find out whether or not she's in on it. Hey, Sapphira, we didn't see your husband. We haven't seen your husband for a little bit. He brought in some money. Was that the whole amount? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, no. Boom, she's down. Peter said to her, how is it that you have agreed together to test the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they'll carry you out. And immediately she fell down at his feet and breathed her last. And when the young men came in, they found her dead, and they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. And great fear came upon the whole church and upon all who heard of these things. Fear of what? The omnipresent, omniscient God from whom you can hide nothing. That all of the secrets that exist in your mind and my mind, in the quiet hours of the night, the little side hustles that you've got going on that no one else knows about.
There's one who does, who's not you. And he is the one with whom you have much to do. My son was a little boy. He'd play hide and seek. And the way he played hide and seek was that he would say, I'm going to hide. And he'd go into the middle of the room and he'd cover his eyes. And you'd walk in and you'd be like, there is something fundamental about me that you misunderstand. I see even when you think I can't. Because you and I can hide our secret thoughts and actions from those around us, we tend to think we're the only ones who know them. But the omnipresent God exists. The omniscient God exists. So let's get real about it. He knows. And then after you start down that clarifying path, you say, okay, well, if he knows, then let me just own it. You can see the effects everywhere. Let me just own what it is that I've done. You got to own up to it. Second, Joel 1, verse 15. Alas for the day, says Joel. For the day of the Lord is near, this phrase right here, the day of the Lord is near, and as destruction from the Almighty, it comes. Is not the food cut off before our eyes? Joy and gladness from the house of our God. That's what's going to happen, apparently, on the day of the Lord. The judgment of God will come upon the unrighteous. Now, what's interesting is that when Joel uses this phrase, he's actually borrowing it or picking up on it from another prophet, and that prophet's name was Ezekiel. In Ezekiel chapter 30, do I have Ezekiel chapter 30? Yes, I do. In Ezekiel chapter 30, here's what it says. The word of the Lord came to me, Ezekiel, son of man, prophesy and say, thus says the Lord God, wail, you see the language? Alas for the day is near, the day of the Lord is near. And you say, okay, what is going to happen on this day of the Lord? It's going to be a day of clouds, so Seattle, okay. A time of doom for the nations, for who? The nations. It's a Jewish prophet pronouncing judgment on the nations. Which nations? Well, a sword will come upon Egypt, and anguish shall be in Cush when the slain fall in Egypt, and the wealth is carried away, and her foundations are torn down. Cush and Put and Lud, great name, and all Arabia and Libya and all the people of the land that's in league, meaning the other nations that are like sponsoring them and are quietly supporting these others, they shall fall with them by the sword. So if you were to read Ezekiel, you'd come away thinking, oh man, the day of the Lord is going to be great because the unrighteous nations who do not worship Yahweh are going to pay the heaviest price. Bring the day of the Lord. Oh, Lord, come. Get them, boy. Right? You see this all over the prophets. The day of the Lord, the day of the Lord, the day of the Lord. Here's my question, ready? In Joel, verse 15 and 16, who is the object of the judgment of the day of the Lord? The nations, or someone else? Alas for the day of the Lord. This is Joel. is near, and as destruction from the Almighty, it comes. And every person's like, yes, day of the Lord, you're going to get them, Yahweh. You're going to actually get those wicked nation. Is not the food cut off before? Whose eyes? Our eyes. Joy and gladness from the house of our God. So Joel's basically saying, hey, you guys remember the day of the Lord? And that, oh, yeah, we remember the day of the Lord. Remember how it's going to be a day for the unrighteous? Yeah, all those wicked unrighteous. Yeah, all you wicked unrighteous. And then Joel does this really interesting thing. He takes a tour with them and says, listen, let's just take a quick tour of what your sin has led to. Here's why I'm calling you the unrighteous. It's obvious. When we just walk around your farm, we see the effects of your sin. Joel 1:17, the seed shrivels under the clods. Don't you see? It's on the ground right there. Come over here, everybody. It's in this, you know, row to hoe, right? Let's go over to the storehouses. They're desolate. The granaries, bigger than the storehouses, are torn down because the grain has dried up. Look at all the bits. Go over to the cows. The herds of cattle are perplexed because there's no pasture for them. It's just brown. Even the flocks of sheep suffer. And when you know the sheep are suffering, everybody's suffering. Don't you look around at your farm? It's completely desolate. Look what the Lord has done. Look at it. Face it. You're the wicked. You're the unrighteous. God sees. He knows. An important part of true repentance is owning up to the effects of our sin. A truly repentant person takes the tour. They look around the farm of their lives, and as they're walking down and they see the desolation here and here and here and here, and they know how they injured this person and how their actions did this to that person and how deep it went. They listen and they pay attention to what is being said. They don't start to fight back. They listen to it. This is what he's saying. Be silent, walk on the tour, and see what has happened here. My sister was we had dogs in our family, and she actually was kind of like an amateur dog whisperer. She's really good at it. But one part I didn't like very much. She used to take the dogs, and if they had peed on the carpet, she'd take their noses and rub it in it, right? By the way, I don't know if that's the modern wisdom on dog training. I have no idea. But for my sister, this was a key part of everything she ever did. When the dog did something wrong, she would actually confront the dog with this. Is Joel's approach here is like, you need to be confronted with what you've done. And when he says this, so many have fallen in line. If you want to make a change in your life, if you want to move on with other people or maybe with God, before you can, there has to be an assessment of the injuries, of the things that have been done to other people. If you go to AA today, Alcoholics Anonymous, and you show up there, they're going to give you a 12-step plan. On the fourth step, quote, make a searching and fearless moral inventory of yourself. The goal is to stop blaming others and own up to your own moral defects and how you've actually hurt others. You get to the point in the AA program where you actually go around and you start telling people, I did this to you, I did this to you, I did this to you. It's not what I mean, perfunctory. When I use that word perfunctory, I don't mean it's just like, meh, whatever, I'll do it so I can tick off the box. It's deep and meaningful. Look at it, stare at it, recognize the ways that you've wronged these dear people. Because the way that you and I handle this sort of thing
is the way the rest of the world handles it, which is, if you come after me, I'm going to shift that blame. Dude, I'm good at it. I'm like the Matrix at it, you know? I can deflect it like Captain America. And so you see people deflecting, even, you know, again, the idiots. Adam and Eve, when they first start out, that's exactly what they're doing in Genesis 3, you know? God's looking for them. He says, have you eaten the tree of which I commanded you not to eat? And the man said, I mean, the answer here is what? Yes, period. Yes. That, yes. But that's not the guy's answer. The first of many men in the history of the world who have started sentences with the woman. And it's not just the woman, though. It's the woman whom you gave. Hey, listen, man, it's her fault. And if it's not her fault, it's your fault because she should have seen this coming, man. I can't be held responsible for the kind of person I am. She gave me the fruit of the tree and I ate. And so he's like, okay, let's talk to her. The Lord said to the woman, what is it that you've done? And the woman said, the serpent. It's not me. Ping. And this is the way that we handle confrontation and have handled confrontation ever since. It's not me. It's you. I got some issues with you. Okay, but yeah, okay, maybe. But that's not what this is about. There's an old joke about a manager who goes in the... He's a baseball manager, and the center fielder commits two easy errors in one inning, and he's so angry. Ball comes to the, you know, comes right to him. It hits off his glove. The next time, he doesn't run fast enough in, and it drops in front of him, and he's just so mad. He picks up another ball, and he throws it over the first baseman's head when he's trying to throw it in. It's just ridiculous. So the manager, when the player comes in, he grabs the glove from the center fielder, and he rips off the guy's hat. He puts the hat on himself. He takes the glove, and in the next inning, he runs to center field himself. First ball that comes to him, he drops. Next ball that shows up, he picks it up, and he throws it over the catcher's head. They finally get all the outs. He runs back in. Center fielder's like, oh, this is going to be good, right? He comes back in. He throws the glove down right at the feet of the center fielder, and he says, you've messed that place up so bad, even I can't fix it. Okay, it's a better joke than what you gave me for it. Or not. There's a celebrity whose name I won't mention, who 4 or 5 years ago actually left a profanity-laced message to his daughter on the phone. He was drunk, but he was mad, and he just laid into his daughter, who then, of course, not liking her dad, published that online. So his publicist has to get involved. This is what the publicist said, quote, although my client acknowledges he should have used different language in parenting his child, everyone who knows him privately knows what he's been put through for the past 6 years, been put through by her. Listen, I wouldn't be screaming at you if you didn't deserve screaming. I hit you because you're so hittable. It's not me. Dude, let me give you the list of reasons why I did this, because clearly these are the reasons, and they're reasonable reasons, and therefore I did this action. Look, if you want to move on with God or others, you will never do so until you're willing to feel the harm your behavior has done. You will never move. I will never move on with God or with others until I'm willing to acknowledge and take the tour of the harm that I've done. Get real about it. Own up to it. Cry out about it. Last two verses. To you, O Lord, I call. This is Joel now. He's been calling out. He's actually been
asking the people to do things and what they should do. And now he's like, I'm just going to intercede. To you, O Lord, I call. Because Joel's part of the nation here. And he's thinking to himself, I don't want the Babylonians to come and absolutely blast us. I want to take an opportunity in this moment of clarity to seek God's face. To see if he'll relent from what he's planning here. To you, O Lord, I call for fire. Now he's using the language. He doesn't mean literal fire. It's as if fire has devoured the pastures of the wilderness. The flame has burned all the trees of the field. Even the beasts of the field, they pant for you. Ever been in a fire? They're so hot, they're panting for you because the water brooks are dried up and the fire has devoured the pastures of the wilderness. We are absolutely without any hope. When God allows you or me to taste the devastation that our sin has wrought, it's an act of grace. It's an act of grace. It's an act of grace for God to be standing next to you as the car of your life has been flipped over and to have his arms there and you thinking to yourself, man, I should have listened to the Lord. This moment of clarity, look, I'll be honest with you, the fact that you're here in the middle of July at church on a Saturday is an act of grace on the part of God. He organized all this, so I'm preaching this weird passage out of Joel. And you're here, you're here listening because God is gracious and he's saying, I'm giving you a chance. The locusts have eaten everything. You know this because I know what you've done. And if you don't turn around, it's going to devastate everything. And in that moment, the only thing to do is to call out, oh God. Here's the good news. He is prone to fits of compassion on the wicked. You know, you expect from God while he's standing next to you to be like, I told you so. But that's not, it's not what you get in Scripture. It's just not what you get in Scripture. What you get, actually, is crazy stuff. Like Jonah, who doesn't want to go and preach repentance to the people of Nineveh. He doesn't want to go. Fish eats him, he goes down, tries to run away. They dump him overboard. Fish eats him, spits him out. He's like, okay, I'll go. He ends up at the edge of Nineveh, and here's, you know, his sermon is ridiculous. Hey, 40 days, God's gonna kill you all. It's like no hope, nothing. 40 days, I'm counting right here, right? I'm just gonna go up on the hill here so I can see when God toasts every one of you. 40 days! That's the sermon. In response to the sermon, the king of Nineveh is like, oh my word. Everybody, sackcloth, ashes, call a solemn assembly. They get down on their hands and knees and they start crying out to God, this pagan nation that's been killing babies for fun, worshiping other gods, wicked. And they cry out to God, and you know what God does? He relents. Which ticks Jonah off, just straight off. And when Jonah has a chance to tell God his opinion, listen to what he says. It displeased Jonah exceedingly. I am not pleased. And he was angry and he prayed to the Lord. This is a great prayer. We're gonna do a series on prayer in the fall. And I thought about including this prayer as don't do this. All right, but listen to what he said. I prayed to the Lord, and he said, oh, Lord, is this not what I said when I was yet in my country? This is the reason I ran away. This is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish. Because I
knew something fundamental about you and your character, that you are a gracious God. How dare you? And you're merciful. Slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, and you relent from disaster. Oh, what a beautiful statement about what our God's like, yeah? Jonah's mad about it, but my idolatrous friends, what a beautiful statement about the nature of our God. He's prone to fits of compassion on the wicked who despise him and hide things from their wickedness, often from him, while they praise his name in public. He's a restoring kind of God. Just ask Peter. You remember Peter? Jesus is up in the trial, standing up to Pilate. Peter's down below. Little girl asks him, aren't you the one? No. Another guy, no. No, you know, rooster. He knows he's totally failed, so he takes off. He takes off. He goes back. He's going to go fishing because it's the only thing that he knows what to do, so he's going to go fishing. He shows up to the beach. He's out there fishing for a while. They don't catch anything. This guy comes days after that whole event happened, days after. This guy comes up on the beach. He shows up, and he's like, hey, put out on the other side. He's like, oh, come on, man. We did this once before. Yes, and Jesus gave us all this stuff, but it's not going to happen. No, just do it. And so he do it. And the same thing that happened when Jesus initially showed up with Peter happens again, and all these fish go into the nets, and Peter's immediately like, oh, my word. It's the Lord. He jumps in the water, and he starts swimming. Wish they had video in those days. You know, he gets to the beach. Jesus is preparing breakfast, fish. Ugh. And they've got, and Jesus asks him some questions. So let me finish with them. When they'd finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, the man who had denied him three times, who had ruined his faith, who had fallen away, abandoned his friend in the most important hour of his life. Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Because remember, Simon, son of John, you said that. You told me that the rest of them will fall away, but you won't. Remember that? And he said to them, yeah, Lord, I do love you. And he said to him, okay, feed my lambs. And then he said to him a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Okay, tend my sheep. And then he said to him the third time, and it occurs to Simon that this is not just hard of hearing Jesus. This is on purpose. Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know it. You know everything. You know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you're old, you'll stretch out your hands and another will dress you and carry you where you don't want to go. This is, he said, to show by what kind of death he was going to glorify God. Peter, you're going to die upside down on a cross. You're going to stretch your hands out there. And after saying this, this is going to cost you everything, Peter. Remember at the beginning when I called you and it cost you everything and then you fell away over those three times? I've asked you three times now and it's going to cost you everything. And he said to him, follow me. Peter, I know what happened in the past. I know what happened. I saw every ounce of it. I saw it in your heart before you even did it. But we're not done with you. You might feel like it's over because you ruined everything and you've just gone back and you're sorrowful and sick of yourself, but it's not over because God's prone to fits of compassion. For some reason, he adores the wicked blasphemers who deny him privately and give him faint praise publicly. He loves us. He's a father scanning the horizon, just waiting for his son to come home. Despite the mess you've made, the Lord isn't done with you. You've got a moment of clarity by his grace. If you're willing to turn away from it, own up to it, and cry out about it, God's willing to start again. He can even restore what the locusts have eaten. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for such a lovely little passage filled with provocative ideas. And I'm mostly thankful for our loving God, who is so prone to these fits of compassion and love over those who don't deserve it. And we get together at church, Father, and we have opportunities to reflect on it. I pray, Father, as we spend the next few minutes in communion, reflecting on the sacrifice made for us for the sins that we have committed, that we would reflect. Reflect on the love of Christ. Reflect on the sinfulness of our souls. And reflect on the constant renewing passion that our God has to bring us home. And I pray, Father, that you would find in us hearts that turn away from the wickedness, even if it's private, even whatever is going on, Father. I pray that you find in us hearts that turn away from it and turn towards you and make restitution where it needs to be made, Father. Would you do your work, Spirit, now, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, church, we're not done just yet. Can I encourage you, invite you to continue to lean into this moment. Continue to lean into what God's doing right now. We're going to take some time and we're going to enter into a time of communion. So in a few minutes, I'll ask the ushers to come up. But if you're here right now, you need to know this. If you're breathing, God is not done with you. He loves you and he's so for you, and you need to know that. Maybe you're here and you're a little unsure about the direction of your life. Come to the Lord, or come back to the Lord, and he can provide clarity and give you purpose and meaning for your life. Or maybe you're living in sin and you're just burdened by the sin that's on your heart. Can I invite you to come back to the Lord? Come to the Lord and he can forgive you. He can restore. Or maybe you're actually angry with God and you want nothing to do with God. As loving as I can say this, come to the Lord. And he is just so loving and so patient and kind, and he cannot wait to meet with you. I'm going to ask the ushers to come up, and we're going to pass the elements of communion. Communion is a family meal for those that believe in Christ. Maybe you're here today and you don't follow Christ, or you're still checking out this Christianity thing. I'm just so glad you're here. Can I just encourage you, would you consider following the Lord? So in a moment, we're going to sing a song over you. Take some time to do business with the Lord. You can stand, you can kneel, you can sit. This is your time with the Lord. Hold on to the elements. Like I said, if you're not a believer, feel free to let the elements pass. And after we sing the song, we'll take the elements together.
Divided. Our repentance starts with your kindness. Coming back to you, Jesus. We're coming back to you, Lord. We're laying down, every empty idol. 'Cause we will always be yours. You're restoring what we've counted lost. Heaven's fortune will be worth the cost, and you will harvest then what we've sown in tears, and we'll reap the joy of 10,000 years. Coming back to you, Jesus. Coming back.
Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the bread now. In the same way, also he took the cup. After supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's stand and respond with a song.
that day we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith, and with one voice a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
That we serve a compassionate God who delivers mercies upon mercies every day. And he knows all of our stuff. But sometimes we can get bogged down with our stuff. But praise God that we can turn it over to him. We can lay it down before him. And so if that's you, or if you fall into any of the categories that Flav had mentioned earlier, let's put some prayer on it, right? We bear one another's burdens in that. And so if you would like prayer, we'll have leaders up front to do that with you. If this is your first time joining us, or if I have not had an opportunity to meet you yet, I would love to do that. I'll be in the lobby after service in the welcome area. And Harvest, remember, as you go out on mission, we serve a God that is like no other, who is forgiving and willing and ready to receive us back onto him at any time. And so let's take that with us as we go out on mission for him this week. Because someone might need that, all right? And remember that you're loved. God bless you.